The purpose of traffic lights is to serve the citizens, not the other way around. Yet inefficient and improperly programmed lights routinely cause as many delays as they avoid. In my opinion, traffic lights are often misused intentionally by the state and towns to earn money through traffic fines. The police page in our local newspaper routinely reports drivers being ticketed for going through red lights, even in the middle of the night when no other cars were anywhere nearby. Badly programmed traffic lights are more than an inconvenience. The unnecessary stopping and starting wastes fuel and increases air pollution. Long and unfair lights also encourage unsafe and aggressive driving, as drivers blast through red lights to avoid a long wait for no reason. This leads to significant increases in traffic accidents, especially rear-end collisions. Drivers often abuse the right-on-red privilege, using it as a license to cut into flowing traffic. Driving is frustrating enough without the DOT making things worse. Besides increasing accidents, poorly configured traffic signals encourage drivers to use inadequate alternate routes, such as residential side streets with bicyclists or children. A traffic light on a main road should never turn red unless cars are actually waiting at the side street. And after the side street cars have passed, the light should change back immediately to favor the main road. It would be great if all traffic lights were as responsive as shown here. Unfortunately, this is usually what happens. How many times have you waited at a side street when no traffic was coming on the main road, only to have the light change just as main road traffic finally approached? Had you been allowed to proceed earlier when there was no other traffic, you wouldn't have had to wait, and cars on the main road wouldn't have had to stop either. Once a line of cars has stopped for a red light, much of the initial time after the light turns green is wasted just getting everyone back up to speed. Therefore, traffic lights should use longer timing periods during rush hours than for the rest of the day. Likewise, cycle times should be short when there are fewer cars to avoid unnecessary waiting. Timings should also vary moment to moment with current traffic conditions. There's no logical reason a traffic light must stay red or green for any minimum amount of time. Traffic lights are very expensive, not just for the equipment, but also for the labor to cut the roads and install the sensors, poles, and lights. A typical intersection costs between $80,000 and $100,000 for lights and installation, plus another $1,000 or $2,000 per year for electricity. Installing traffic lights at a large, complex intersection can cost almost $500,000. The traffic lights at most intersections employ a sensor installed under the roadway to detect when a car passes over it. These sensors are similar to metal detectors hobbyists use, but with much larger coils embedded in the road. The sensors tell the traffic control box that a car is waiting and to change to a green light. But these simplistic sensors aren't programmed to distinguish cars turning wide into a street. Nor do they respond when a car turns right on red and thus no longer needs a green light. They could, but they don't. Here in the Northeast U.S., the roads shift or crack during cold winters, and sometimes the sensor wires break. Unfortunately, when sensors break, the DOT may simply set the lights for fixed red-green timing rather than repair the sensors so the lights respond to traffic demands. A sensor in Ridgefield, Connecticut at this intersection of Main and Governor Streets was broken for the entire 4 years I lived in the area. Day or night, every car and truck on busy Main Street had to stop for side road traffic that wasn't there, and then wait another 30 seconds because the pedestrian walk light was always included in the cycle, even when nobody pressed the push button. Now, 16 years later, you can see that the lights at this intersection are still broken. For a further example of incompetence, or perhaps greed, notice the no turn on red sign. This is a T intersection with no road or driveway on the left. Is it a coincidence that the Ridgefield Police Station is nearby? Much of the inefficiency of traffic lights is due to incompetent programming. For example, When a road has a dedicated left turn lane, the green arrow advance should never be triggered unless a car is actually in that lane waiting to turn left. Otherwise, opposing cars must wait an extra 10 to 30 seconds for no reason. But unwarranted delays occur even without a dedicated left turn lane. Traffic engineers will tell you that unless there's a dedicated lane for left turns, there's no way to skip the green arrow advance. This is wrong. If there's no traffic at all in that lane, the detectors know that and the controller can be programmed to let opposing traffic proceed immediately. In both of these intersection videos, no cars were in the left lane, yet that lane still received a left arrow advance, making oncoming traffic wait for no reason. Even when intersections have a dedicated left turn lane, many get an advance at every cycle anyway, even when no cars are in that lane to take advantage. Again, this makes oncoming traffic wait for no reason. Worse, many dedicated left turn lanes prohibit turning left until the green arrow is given, even when oncoming traffic can be seen for a mile away. It's rare for lights at adjacent intersections to be synchronized, which often results in traffic waiting to get a green light, only to have to stop again at another light a block ahead. Although synchronization of successive lights is a laudable goal, when done poorly it makes traffic stop for no reason. A light should never change if no cars will benefit, or only to follow an inflexible sequence as shown here. Further, it's impossible to synchronize lights fully anyway unless the road is one way. The best we can aim for on a two-way street is for all the lights to change together, so at least nobody has to stop at successive intersections. In a nutshell, traffic lights should do exactly what a police officer directing traffic would do, and there's no good reason they can't. This intersection in Brookfield, Connecticut is a great example of poor synchronization. Most of the cars going north will turn right at the intersection ahead, and little traffic ever comes from the side road on the left. But even when no cars are on that side road, the first light always turns red, preventing traffic on the main road from continuing toward their right turn. This intersection is especially exasperating because the main road is stopped constantly, even when no traffic is present on either side road, as you can see here. Many lights could be flashing red and yellow most of the time, and active only during morning and evening rush hours, but that's rarely done. Indeed, even at normally busy intersections, most traffic lights could be set to flash red and yellow between 9 or 10 p.m. and 7 a.m. There are also intersections where lights are needed but never installed. The intersection of Route 67 and Grove Street here in New Milford was very dangerous because of short sight lines coupled with a sharp curve. All that was needed was a single light at that intersection, active only during daytime hours. Instead, the town chose to reroute the last 300 feet of Grove Street. The cost of the bypass road was originally estimated at $4 or $5 million, but now that the work is nearly complete, we learn the true cost is more than $28 million, and all we needed was a single traffic light. Allowing right turn on red is useful at most intersections, though many have no turn on red signs even when the line of sight extends far enough to see what's coming. Were side street cars allowed to go right on red at these intersections, and the lights programmed to cancel the green light request after they left the intersection, there'd be one less impediment for traffic on the main road. In my opinion, drivers should be able to go right, left, or even straight on red after a stop, as long as no other cars are approaching. After a car goes right on red, the light is no longer needed, yet not one traffic light in Connecticut I'm aware of cancels a call request after the car leaves the intersection. The technology to implement traffic control intelligently exists and is present in all modern traffic control boxes already installed. The state and local traffic departments simply need to program the controllers more intelligently. Even when sensors work as intended, additional sensors placed farther from the intersection would help enormously by seeing what's coming sooner and responding appropriately. This is not rocket science. Equipment to handle traffic lights efficiently has been available for many years. The problem is the DOT doesn't know what to buy or how to use it. Years ago, in the 1960s, I visited the Automatic Signal Company in my hometown of Norwalk, Connecticut, and spoke to a senior design engineer. The automatic signal company pioneered using computers to control traffic signals back in 1963. I asked their engineer why traffic lights in our town worked so poorly, and he told me the real reason was incompetence. He said the town engineer simply don't know how to program the devices properly, even though his company offers assistance. So it's not only incompetence, but also arrogance. Wasted time and wasted fuel are caused not only by traffic lights, but also by stop signs. Many stop signs could be yield signs, at least at more rural intersections or where the line of sight is clear. A four-way yield would be treated like a four-way stop, except you don't have to come to a full stop if nobody else is approaching. Often, stop signs are installed on residential roads just to reduce speeding, when a fairer approach would be better enforcement. Speed bumps are even more insulting, as are stop signs at driveways or other locations that are not legitimate intersections. Speed limits are often set poorly. I joke that the people who set the speed limits probably don't drive that slowly themselves. A 1992 study by the U.S. Department of Transportation concluded that raising or lowering speed limits by as much as 20 miles per hour has little effect on the speeds people actually drive. Apparently, most people have more common sense than the government gives us credit for. Further, accidents at the sites where speed limits were lowered increased by 5.4%, and accidents where speed limits were raised decreased by 6.7%. Having different speed limits for day and night could also make sense on some roads, especially rural roads without overhead streetlights. In my area, it's common for the state or a town to pave a section of road, then fail to paint the dividing line until weeks or even months later. This is not a big problem during the day, but at night when the roads are wet, it can be very difficult to see the road lanes, especially in the bright lights of oncoming traffic. No critique of traffic control would be complete without a mention of toll booths. Highway tolls are an inefficient way to collect money, wasting time and fuel as everyone has to stop and idle while waiting. In many cases, highway tolls earn less money for a state than the federal government would give them in subsidies were the tolls removed. For decades, Connecticut imposed tolls on its major highways, even though the tolls earned less than the state would have gotten from federal subsidies. Toll booths are also dangerous. After a 1983 truck crash killed 7 people at the I-95 toll plaza in Stratford, Connecticut, 2 years later the state of Connecticut removed the tolls on I-95. 3 years later, the state abolished tolls on all highways. While the 1983 Stratford accident was given as the main reason for abolishing tolls, the real reason was because federal legislation at the time forbade states with toll roads from receiving federal funds for road projects. Prior to their removal in 1985, tolls on the Connecticut Turnpike generated over $65 million annually, but Connecticut received $2.6 billion in federal highway funds that they wouldn't have gotten had the tolls remained. Finally, I have to mention a pet peeve of mine, roadside spam that is illegal yet never punished. State and local departments of transportation should fine roadside spammers and add the revenues to the general fund. The fine for littering on Connecticut state highways is $245 per offense, and that would earn the state literally millions of dollars per year. I once proposed to the state a program to track down and fine roadside spammers, but nobody in the government cared enough to follow up. Every one of these signs includes a phone number, making the offenders easy to identify. As we have seen, many traffic lights are poorly implemented, mainly due to incompetence, but also as a revenue source in some cases. Even though the technology exists for traffic lights to work as intelligently as a police officer directing traffic manually, this is rarely done. In fairness, not all traffic lights are incompetent, though too many are. When there's a steady flow of traffic in all directions, everyone has to stop anyway, even if the light is on a fixed timing cycle without using road sensors, heavy traffic can flow as well as can be expected, assuming the cycle times are appropriate. But the majority of traffic lights are inefficient and unfair, especially at non-peak hours.
Da 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 da